Hi, everybody. Welcome to Cloud Cover. My name is Chris Reisner, and today I've got two special guests from Barracuda, Jeff Johnson and Oliver Way. Would you guys like to introduce yourselves?
Sure.
So I'm Jeff Johnson. I'm a systems engineer with Barracuda Networks.
My name is Oliver Way. I am on the product marketing and product management team at Barracuda Networks.
Can you tell us a little bit about what Barracuda Networks is and what you guys do?
Sure. So what we have is we have cloud-connected storage and security solution. We've been around for about, I'd say about almost 10 years now. We recently IPO'd. Yeah, so it's been a good run for us.
Great.
We started our partnership with Microsoft about a year ago, specifically on Azure. One of the guys on the business development team reached out to us to talk about, you know, how we can move some of our security solution onto Windows Azure, and we've been working with Microsoft for the last about a year and a half now.
Great. Well, security is obviously a very, very important topic, so I'm excited to see what you guys are bringing to Windows Azure and what we can do with this.
Absolutely. So I guess we can get started, and really what we have is, right now we have two solutions. One is our web application firewall, which we'll spend most of the time here today, but I also want to introduce our next generation firewall, which we will hopefully cover in a future session.
Okay.
But really briefly, you know, from a high level, our web app firewall is essentially a layer 7 application security solution, so this provides all of the OWASP top 10 protection, the inbound outbound scanning for malicious attacks coming inbound, as well as data loss prevention for sensitive packages coming outbound. So some of the key use cases, you know, we have the ability to essentially be the WAF for applications that you migrate from on-premise onto the Azure cloud, as well as, you know, work with dynamic elastic applications, like say like a mobile application that needs security but also needs the elasticity to scale up and scale down as necessary. And finally, because we have a granular identity and access management capability, we have the ability to do, you know, things like SharePoint publishing, you know, that you might have done with Microsoft TMG on-premise.
Mm-hmm.
You can do the same thing and move it to Azure with the web application firewall.
So if I'm going to move my applications from my premise to the cloud, this is going to be a really easy solution for securing those one time in Windows
absolutely.
Azure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So also, you know, I just want to briefly introduce our next generation firewall. And essentially, you know, it's something that we are going to be releasing pretty soon.
Okay.
So this is something that we're very excited about. It provides secure remote access, you know, cross-premise connectivity, so it doesn't matter if it's from VNet to VNet, site to site, you know, client to site. It has the ability to do, you know, secure tunnels, and it's really easy to manage because we built the centralized management from day one. So you can scale to thousands of nodes, you know, or whatnot. So this is something we're very excited about.
So this is quite literally the next generation of the web application firewall?
Well, it's actually a separate product.
Oh,
so
okay.
It's more of a next generation network firewall.
Okay.
That allows you to do a lot of things. And some of the use cases that we have, you know, that we've talked to some Azure customers that are really exciting for them are things like secure high-speed VPN. You know, we can go up to a gigabit plus in terms of throughput.
It's pretty fast.
Yeah, and we can do multi-tier networks. So essentially, what this allows you to do is to take whatever you have on-prem, your network architecture, pick that up, forklift it, and drop it into Azure, you know, without any real modifications, though.
Mm-hmm.
So you can preserve, you know, the networks that you're used to, as well as have the ability to provide the same level of protection.
Great, I love it when it's seamless.
Yeah, absolutely. And then the last thing, you know, like I mentioned before, site-to-site connectivity. So, you know, once again, this is pretty much anything-to-anything type of VPN. So site-to-site, off-prem, on-prem, you know, branch office to Azure. So it gives you the flexibility to do whatever deployments that are good for you guys.
Great.
Excellent. So, but today I want to talk really just about a web application firewall. So just to give you a little bit of background, this is a product that's been around since 1999. So it's a mature product that has, you know, over a decade of R&D. It secures a lot of large Fortune 500 type of organization, all the way down to, you know, smaller organization that just needs something for PCI compliance. So,
okay.
So it's been around for a while. You know, we're very excited, and it's in Azure. So just a very high level, what it does. It does three things. At the very beginning, it does essentially application protection from the inbound side. So because the web app firewall is a full reverse proxy, what allows you to do is to essentially terminate all the traffic on the instance itself, scan for any malicious content, and then depending on if it's clean or not, then pass that to the back end.
Okay.
And the second thing it does is what we call essentially proactive defenses. So what that allows you to do is to essentially, you know, do things ahead of time. So usually the way that applications are attacked is the first thing that attackers will do is to probe your defenses to figure out what's on the back end, kind of see if you can see any server signatures or all
that
stuff.
Figure out
what
you're running, essentially.
Exactly, exactly. So what we can do is we can mask all that information. So things like error code, things like, you know, HTTP headers that might give a hint on what it actually is running in the background. Mm-hmm. You know, we can mask all that stuff out so that there's nothing that gets leaked out into the internet.
Okay, great.
And then the final thing is, because it sits as a reverse proxy, all of traffic going outbound is also scanned by the web app firewall. So, you know, social security numbers, credit card numbers, you know, anything that's sensitive or any sensitive patterns you want to create, that can also be blocked, either masked out like a credit card, the first 12 numbers, X'd out, or the whole page gets blocked itself.
So if I'm a developer and I'm not so smart and I'm returning, you know, all my customers' credit card numbers through some simple
right.
open web API call, I could use this to make sure, that
absolutely.
Doesn't happen.
Absolutely. And a lot of times, data leakages happen, it's not because, you know, you're not a good engineer. You know, there's a lot of good engineers out there, but mistakes sometimes happen.
Absolutely.
And we think that, you know, having a platform like this, it just adds another layer of defense.
Absolutely. Very important.
So just want to talk a little bit about some of the advanced capabilities that we have. We have our advanced DDoS protection. So what's really cool about this is that it can do two things that's different from a lot of other organizations that might have a web app firewall, and that's, you know, JavaScript botnet fingerprinting, right? So it allows you to take a look at the client and determine if it is a human sending the request or some sort of, you know, a botnet type of zombie machine sending automatic probes against your system. So if we can detect that it's something that's kind of suspicious, you know, based on a JavaScript botnet detection, or if the fingerprint seems kind of suspect, we have the ability to then, you know, do things like do a captcha injection. You know,
okay.
So what this allows you to do is to detect traffic, essentially score what the risk profile is, and if it crosses a certain threshold, you can do some sort of mitigation steps to protect.
It's almost like a dynamic insertion of a capture, like, hey,
that's
I'm not
right.
so sure this person's real. Let's just
that's
test
right.
them out.
That's right. And then the best thing about it, all of this, is that there's no coding involved. The platform does everything for you, so you don't have to change anything on the backend server, and it's all done automatically.
Perfect.
And then the last thing before I hand it over to Jeff, I wanted to quickly talk about, you know, some of the capabilities that are beyond the security part of it. So this is an all-in-one platform, though. So it has load balancing, server health monitoring, you know, the sticky session persistence based on cookies or IP addresses. You know, it can do SSL acceleration, authentication, access control, pretty much anything you'll need for a quick deployment.
Mm-hmm.
One of the design philosophies that we had for when building the product was that if we were to give you, you know, a security solution but impacted performance, you know, this wouldn't be the most ideal thing for any organization. So
yep.
What we decided to do is that not only do we want to secure your application, but also accelerate it to make sure that your clients get the performance that they're expecting.
Great. Very awesome.
And at this point, I think I'll hand it over to Jeff, who will do the real important stuff.
All right, let's see some code sort of stuff.
Yeah. So the first thing I want to talk to you about is how to deploy the WAF in Azure to secure your applications. So when you deploy the WAF into Azure, it is a VM. So it does sit in IS. It sits on either a small, medium, large, or extra large instance.
Mm-hmm.
And as you can see from the diagram here, we have two of them for availability, right?
Mm-hmm.
So as you look at the traffic flow as it comes in, traffic's going to hit the Azure load balancer. It's going to hit the WAFs, and it's going to load balance requests between those WAFs.
Mm-hmm.
Those two WAFs are actually going to load balance requests for the applications that it's hosting.
So everything's going to end up going through the WAF to make sure it's secure.
That's right. So when you deploy your applications, whether they're in IaaS or PaaS, you deploy them into the virtual network. You make sure that there's no public endpoints available. So all web traffic does go through the WAF.
Okay.
And then in PaaS, as a web app, or I'm sorry, as another server spins up based on load or whatever requirements you have,
mm-hmm.
it can actually register with the WAF using our REST API.
Okay.
And so the WAF starts to poll it. We'll send health checks. And
okay.
then when it starts responding to health checks, we add it to the load balancing pool and we start sending traffic
okay.
to it.
So if I've got, you know, auto-scaling some of that set up, whenever I've got a new instance that spins up, it's going to go and say, hey, WAF, I'm here.
That's
start
right.
giving me stuff.
That's right. It adds
great.
It to the load balancing pool. And then when that server goes away, on the on-stop, it actually registers again with the API.
Mm-hmm.
And we delete it out of the config.
Great.
So the next thing I want to talk about is just how you're going to actually do that. And I need to transition into Visual Studios for that.
Sure.
So when you're building your project, and there's a couple modifications to make to actually make sure that you're only allowing internal access to it. So one, in the service configuration.cloud file, you can actually go and add a portion that says which network, which vSite, I'm sorry, which network you're going to actually deploy in, mm-hmm. and what subnet you're going to deploy in. And so in that case, you know that the WAF and the application server are going to be in the same subnet.
Right.
And the other modification you can make is to make sure that the endpoint is actually an internal endpoint.
Okay.
And then the only other thing left to do is to make a firewall change on the server that comes up to allow it to respond to requests from internal.
Right.
And so after you do that, you're pretty much ready to publish your application. And once you publish it, you actually see that it actually, the server actually appears on the WAF after it registers.
Okay, but essentially those two changes are really all you have to do on your config side to kind of just lock your thing down so it's just responding internally to the WAF.
That's it. That's all you have to do.
Great.
So now I'm actually into the WAF UI. And I got to log in. And as you can see, I'm using the admin password. If this was production, you obviously wouldn't be using that. And the other thing you can see is I'm actually managing it through the cloud service.
Okay.
If you were in production, you would manage it through the VPN connection. You wouldn't actually go through the cloud service
right.
to manage it. So just some caveats on my demo here. So the first thing that greets you when you log in is going to be the status page.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, it's just showing you a quick snapshot of, hey, this is what we're doing so far, right? So you have some web firewall statistics. You also have the number of active services and servers, right?
Mm-hmm.
So as you take a quick look at this, you can see if there are some servers that are down or some servers that are services that are actually down as well. So in the previous slide, I actually showed you that there were two WAFs in that cloud service, right?
Yep.
Well, two is for availability, but it can scale. So you can have 5, 10, however many is needed based on your throughput requirements.
Okay.
And it's really hard to manage 10 WAFs, right? So what we do have is what we call configuration sync. And what config sync does is any change that's made to one WAF
mm-hmm.
gets propagated to every other WAF and through the config cluster.
Okay, now is it sort of like a master slave concept where you have one WAF that you change, or is it any WAF that changes will then go and tell the other WAFs, hey, here's some changes?
Any WAF you change goes and tells the other WAFs.
Great, that's convenient.
So you only need to actually manage one.
Cool.
And from that one, you can actually go and secure your policy, make any changes, and it'll propagate out.
Great.
And you do see that I only have 3 up. That's because I have the other instance down.
Okay.
So deploying your app is really easy, because all you have to do is provide it a couple pieces of information.
Mm-hmm.
So we already know what our IP address is as we sit into the virtual network.
Mm-hmm.
So you just give it just a simple service name. Tell it what kind of protocol it is, right? So we do protocol compliance for HTTP mm-hmm. and HTTPS traffic. This is our internal IP address. This is what's going to hit our VIP after the traffic passes through the Azure load balancer.
Mm-hmm.
Then you tell it what port that we're listening for traffic on. Now you can tell it what server it is right here, right now, or you can just wait and just have the servers actually register.
Okay.
So I could go ahead and add that in this application will get propagated to all three WAFs that are up right now.
Great.
So a little bit more about that. So you see, we only really provided 3 pieces of information, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you secure based on that? Well, it's by default, we actually add what we call a security policy. And mm-hmm. it's the default security policy. It's really a combination of a bunch of different components based on requests and responses to ensure that we can secure your application.
Okay.
So by default, when we load an application or we add a service, we put it in passive mode. And what passive mode is going to allow you is the ability to make your application available and then tune the security policy as it's available. So typically we would say, hey, have your developers or your QA group go through, test the app. And then since we're in passive mode, we're not going to block anything.
Right.
We're just going to log any violations into the web firewall logs.
And when violations might be something like some sort of a malicious like injection or anything?
It could be a malicious injection, or it could be that maybe the page that your user is browsing, maybe there's the parameter length of parameters too long.
Okay.
I mean, something simple as that, right?
But anything that it thinks is weird, it's going to let you know.
Anything that triggers a violation will trigger a log into the web firewall log.
Okay.
And after you've deployed the app and you've run through it a little bit, get some user traffic, you can actually go in and take a look and see what's happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
So as you look at the logs here, you see that we do see a lot of SQL injections, a lot of cross-site scriptings, and we can look at the details of that. And it gives you everything about that request, what the client IP import was, what the service port was, and then what the action was.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I told you that when we deploy in passive mode, so we just log.
Right.
This service actually is in, this is a different service, but it's in active mode, which means we're going to do whatever's configured into the action policy as far as what the response from the WAF is going to be.
Okay.
So this was actually denied. And you could look at it, and you could see that it was a SQL injection.
And now, so there's the default security policy that's passive. Once you can you just switch that to active, and it's already set up to kind of do the general, you know, SQL injection, cross-site scripting detections, and stuff like that.
Yeah. So even when you deploy in the passive mode, we're still using all those same attack definitions. We're still looking at traffic mm-hmm. based on the context of when it comes in.
Sure.
So you can actually start in active mode if you want.
Mm-hmm.
It's not really best practices.
Sure.
But you could do it.
Okay.
So another thing to actually look at is, so say you're cruising through your logs and you see a request like this, right? Parameter length exceeded. So if you're the developer, you could actually look at this and say, oh, you know what? Yeah, I am allowing that parameter name to be that long.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a false positive, so you need to make a change on the WAF. If you weren't the developer, then I would suggest you go find your developer, ask him.
Sure. Is that real? Makes sense.
And then to actually tune the policy, it's as easy as clicking the fix button. It comes up, it gives you what the recommended fix will be.
Okay.
And so this one is just going to extend the length of the, the policy.
And it looks like there's fixes you can do probably relatively easily for any of those sort of situations.
That's correct.
Great.
So for any violation, you actually have a remediation.
Right. And this is the sort of thing here where if you make this change here, it's then going to propagate to your other WAFs.
That's correct.
Perfect.
So it'll make the config change here and then propagate out.
Great.
So I'm going to go back to the services tab. And you know, when we run in Azure, each WAF has its own internal IP, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only IP address that we can actually listen for traffic on.
Yep.
But that doesn't limit you from running multiple applications inside to the WAF itself. So one WAF can handle multiple applications.
Mm-hmm.
So on this one here, I have a Joomla server listening on port 80. I have the same Joomla server listening on port 443. And then I have two other test apps that don't have servers connected to them right now. But if you look at this application, so I have two apps here actually for port 80, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I have an app 1 and an app 2. And we use content rules to actually specify, hey, if I get a request in, based on something in that request, I can route it to any server that I want to.
Okay.
And even after I route it, I can load balance and maintain persistence between those servers as well.
Great.
And if most customers are going to be using SSL, so to have multiple applications for SSL, you need to have a wildcard certificate,
mm-hmm.
or you need to use server name indication. And we use server name indication, so as the client sends a request, before the SSL handshake, we look and see what domain they're requesting, and then we provide that certificate.
Okay, great.
So it makes it really easy to store multiple SSL-enabled applications behind the WAF. The other thing is, Oliver mentioned it a little bit, is we can either offload SSL or we can re-encrypt and go to the back end. It's just a matter of what your security policy is.
Okay, great.
So I talked a little bit about the security policy. I'm going to go just a little bit into it. There's a lot of functionality on the WAF, and I don't think you want to sit here all day while I go through it.
Sounds like there's probably a bit there.
So, I mean, we do things like request limits, right?
Mm-hmm.
So where people are looking for trying to do a buffer overflow attack. So
sure.
They'll send a bunch of data, and they'll hope that they can actually break into the application.
Mm-hmm.
So we do request limits. We do cookie security. So as a cookie goes out, we'll sign it. When the client sends that cookie back in, we verify that it hasn't been tampered with.
Okay.
And if it has, we drop the cookie. And we also do URL and parameter protection. And for URL and parameter protection, you can specify what the allowed methods are, what the allowed content types are, and then if you want to do cross-site request forgery or not. And also, if you're uploading files, how many files can you upload?
Okay.
So on the WAF, we have an antivirus scanner for file uploads. So if you have a SharePoint site and you're allowing users to upload files, you can actually run a virus scan on those files before they get put onto the server.
Great.
So when you look at URL protection, so if I send a request here and I use, say, bedit or bdelete, and that's not allowed method, that would be a violation of the policy.
Right.
And you'd see that logged into the web firewall logs. So the other thing I want to show you is going to be the action policy. And the action policy is pretty much where it says, hey, for any violation, what do you want the WAF to do?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of things we can do. So we deny a log, we can allow, and you can do this on a per violation basis. You can send a response, or you can redirect to a specified URL that you configure. We ship with multiple response pages, but you can create your own response page and send that out to clients. And then the follow-up action is we can block an offending IP for a specified amount of time, or you can challenge them with a CAPTCHA.
Right.
So everything that I talked to you about right now is pretty much focused on the negative security model.
Sure.
Right? So we're looking for known bad. You can also choose to deploy using the positive security model. And whatever your preference is, it's very... The WAF will actually allow you. So we can do totally negative, we can do totally positive,
mm-hmm.
or we can do a combination of both, which is what we really see as being the best case.
Sure.
So for positive, you would have your app, your QA testers go in, run through the application while we learn based on the request and response
mm-hmm.
using that trusted host. And then once it's built, you have a couple options. And one of the options is when it says use profile, yes, and strict, yes. That means anything that's not in the profile. If there's a request, and there's not a URL profile or a parameter profile that matches that, that's a violation and we'll block it.
Okay, so basically if somebody's trying something that doesn't, you haven't really tested, you haven't used, it's not gonna go through.
That's correct.
Great.
But websites and applications change all the time, right?
Sure.
So if you're gonna use the positive, then you have to go back and you have to relearn.
Right.
You have to know what the changes are. So if you set strict is equal to no, what happens is if there's a request that comes and it doesn't match anything in the policy,
mm-hmm.
then we actually evaluate it against the default URL parameter protection.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't violate that, we allow it to go through.
Okay.
So it gives you the flexibility to say, hey, I have a profile. Maybe my profile is not totally up to date, but I still don't impact my users as long as it's not a malicious request.
Right.
So I talked a little bit about positive. Negative security model. I talked a little bit about tuning the policy manually using the web firewall logs. But we do have the ability to actually tune the logs automatically.
Mm-hmm.
And this causes, it's great for administrators, right? So what you can do is use our exception profiling. And what this does is pretty much it means based on a trigger count, right? So if I get 3 requests from 3 unique IP users for the same violation, I have the ability to specify whether I want the WAF to automatically adjust the policy. And what you would do is you would configure this, and then to actually look in one spot for the recommended changes,
mm-hmm.
you would just come down here to the exception profile, the pending recommendations.
Okay.
So it's a way if you want the box to automatically tune, you can do it. But you saw from my screen, I had it manual, right?
Right.
I want to know what changes the box is going
to
make.
But basically, we're making it very easy for administrators to kind of, not have to be here every second of the day checking things out. Okay, great.
And then the only other thing I want to talk to you about, there's 2 things actually. It's going to be, IP reputation that Oliver talked about.
Mm-hmm.
So what we're seeing with some of our customers in Azure is they're deploying apps. And those apps are pretty much only for their employees that are located in the States.
Okay.
So if you get a request from China or a request from some other nation, they don't really want to waste time handling that request.
Makes sense.
So what we have is IP reputation. So IP reputation allows you to create IP reputations pools based on regions. And you can go through and select whichever region you want and make an IP pool policy, right?
So I can make my app only respond to people in Antarctica if I want to.
You can.
Fantastic.
That's exactly right.
Finally know how.
So then once you make your pool, then you can go and you can turn actual the IP reputation filter on. So for here, I have an IP reputation pool. It's for India, and I'm choosing India because I have a traffic generator that's actually shooting traffic to the WAF right now. That's where those logs come from.
Okay.
So I could turn this on, choose India, and then after I save changes here, we'll go back and we'll look at the access logs and the web firewall logs, mm-hmm. and we'll notice that traffic is actually stopped.
Okay.
So my last request was at 10:21. You see, I'm not getting any more requests. So then I can go and I can look at our network firewall logs.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll see that I'm actually dropping all these requests
okay.
that are hitting from India.
Okay. So again, you know, a lot of options there. If you're getting DDoS from a specific area or something like that, you can temporarily or maybe even permanently just block access to prevent that from happening.
That's correct.
Great. That's, you know, preventing DDoS is definitely very important, so it's great to see how easy it is to take care of.
I'm just going to turn this off.
Sure.
And then the other thing that I wanted to mention is we integrate with a bunch of different SIM providers.
Okay.
So if you're using Q1 Radar, if you're using Splunk, or anything, we can syslog out using syslogng
mm-hmm.
to your SIM, and you can do your notification and reporting from there.
Okay, great.
Very anything I missed? Anything you want to go over?
I guess the only
other thing is on the IP reputation database. What we also have is our Barracuda Labs, and essentially what it'll do is it'll profile all the different IP addresses based on our different security products that are both, you know, in Azure and not in Azure,
mm-hmm.
to give essentially a risk scoring of all the different IP addresses that we categorize. So this is, you know, things like our content filtering solution, our email solution, our network firewall solution, our web app firewall. So all that information
mm-hmm.
gets fed back into our centralized database, and all this, you know, information is then sent out to the WAF automatically.
Okay, so basically it's not just my WAF dictating whether or not an IP
That's
is
right.
bad. It's kind of your whole infrastructure saying,
That's
hey,
right.
we know this IP is bad, even if
That's
it hasn't
right.
hit your WAF yet. So the next time it does,
That's
I can
right.
say, I already know.
Yeah.
Great. Very cool.
Cool. So, you know, the last thing I just wanted to quickly talk about really are some of the resources that are there for you know, potential users that might be interested in testing this out.
Mm-hmm.
The great thing about Barracuda is that we believe in the, you know, try before you buy.
Always a good thing.
Always a good thing, right? So we provided a free 30-day trial. So all you have to do is to go to this link, basically enter your information, and then it will give you a link location as well as a key to build of the web application firewall on Azure.
Okay.
So you can then move that onto your instance and then get it all running. And then within 30 days, you know, if you decide that this is something of interest for you, you know, you can then give us a call and then we can activate that license
Great.
Permanently.
And now, one of these guides here, will this walk us through kind of everything we did today, like setting it up, deploying it, integrate with my application, all that stuff?
Absolutely. So that's the technical library. So what we call techlib.barracuda.com.
Okay.
If you go there, it will have all the deployment guides. It'll have, you know, best practices, you know, a wealth of information for you to essentially walk yourself through. If you don't, if you have some challenges, you know, we also provide 24/7 support. All you would have to do is to go to the Azure_support@barracuda.com email alias,
mm-hmm.
you know, punch in your information, and somebody will give you a call or email you back with anything you might actually need.
That's great.
If you need something more on, you know, white papers and more kind of a business case and why this is an important solution,
mm-hmm.
you can go to our Barracuda Azure landing page.
Okay.
There's also a bunch of different information, you know, and white papers on the solution itself, as well as a link back to our technical library. So it's a good launching point for, you know, anything you might want to do.
Great, and we'll make sure those links are down beneath the video, so you can get to them a little bit easier.
Right.
Great.
So I think with that, you know, this is the end of our prepared remarks, I suppose. And
all right. Well, I think I got my questions in, but I'm sure there'll be questions in the comments once we post the video.
Okay.
Thank you guys so much for coming out. It's really great to see how easy it is to integrate some really powerful application security into Windows Azure. As always, thanks everybody for watching. Please follow us on Facebook and at the Cloud Cover Show. Do you guys have Twitter handles you want to share in case people want to reach out to you?
I don't have one, but no? I'm sure our PR department has one.
Okay, we'll make sure we get that and we'll have it right here so you can reach out to their Twitter handle.
Right.
So thanks again for coming, guys. I look forward to hearing more about this and the next generation firewall in the future.
Yeah, thank you.
Great.
Good to be here.
Thanks everybody for watching.
Bye.
Bye-bye.